Turn with me over to the book of Acts. We are in Acts chapter 27, almost to the end of the book. Just one more chapter to go after we finish this particular passage. Amazing what God did in the life of the Apostle Paul. Wonderful example for us in our Christian life. How he pressed on regardless of the difficulty. He never complained. He never griped about it. He never wished somebody had made it easier for him or had gotten out of his way. He would want the soft and easy path? No, the Apostle Paul wanted to be in the center of God's will. And many times you and I, as we face the various troubles of life, spend our time moaning and groaning and complaining and belly aching and telling God how bad it is, and we wish it was a lot easier, and we haven't even begun to face the kind of things that other people, who are the servants of God, have faced with faithfulness, courage, and cheer. Tonight, swimming on a full stomach, part number two. You remember, there's a big storm going on. Now, I'm going to give you a little bit of review here because we've had 2 weeks off. Last time we were in Acts was on December 11th, and then we had the candlelight service of lessons and carols on the 18th, then the Christmas Sunday, no evening service. So tonight, we're back in Acts chapter 27, and although our text is verse 38 through 44, I'm going to read from verse 14 because that sets us in the proper context. But not long after, there arose against it a tempestuous wind called Euroclydon. And when the ship was caught and could not bear up into the wind, we let her drive. And running under a certain island, which is called Clauda, we had much work to come by the boat, which when they had taken out, they used helps undergirding the ship, and fearing lest they should fall into the quicksands, strike sail, and so were driven. And we, being exceeding tossed with the tempest, the next day they lightened the ship, and the third day we cast out with our own hands the tackling of the ship. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. But after long abstinence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, Sirs, ye should have hearkened unto me, and not have loosed from Crete, and to gain this harm and loss. But now, I exhort you to be of good cheer, for there shall be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship. For there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am, and whom I serve, saying, Fear not, Paul, thou must be brought before Caesar, and lo, God hath given thee all them that sail with thee. Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God that it shall be even as it was told me. Howbeit, we must be cast upon a certain island. And when the 14th night was come, as we were driven up and down in Adria about midnight, the shipmen deemed that they drew near to some country, and sounded, and found it 20 fathoms. And when they had gone a little further, they sounded again, and found it 15 fathoms. And fearing, lest we should have fallen upon rocks, they cast 4 anchors out of the stern, and wished for the day. And as the shipmen were about to flee out of the ship, when they had let the boat down into the sea, under color, as though they would have cast anchors out of the foreship, Paul said to the centurion and to the soldiers, Except these abide in the ship, ye cannot be saved. Then the soldiers cut off the ropes off the boat and let her fall off. And while the day was coming on, Paul besought them all to take meat, saying, This day is the 14th day that ye have tarried and continued fasting, having taken nothing. Wherefore I pray you to take some meat, for this is for your health. For there shall not an hair fall from the head of any of you. And when he had thus spoken, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of all them. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. Then were they all of good cheer, and they also took some meat. And we were in all in the ship 260 souls. And when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship and cast out the wheat into the sea. And when it was day, then they knew not the land, but they discovered a certain creek with a shore, into the which they were minded, if it were possible, to thrust in the ship. And when they had taken up the anchors, they commended themselves to the sea, and loosed the rudder bands, and hoisted up the mainsail to the wind, and made towards shore. And falling into a place where two seas met, they ran the ship aground, and the foreport stuck fast, and remained unmovable, but the hinder part was broken with the violence of the waves. And the soldiers' counsel was to kill the prisoners, lest any of them should swim out and escape. But the centurion, willing to save Paul, kept them from their purpose and commanded that they which could swim should cast themselves first into the sea and get to land, and the rest, some on boards and some on broken pieces of the ship. And so it came to pass that they escaped all safe to land. Gracious Father, again we commit ourselves and your word to this, the proclamation of it. We pray, Father, that you might use the word of God to motivate us, to stir us, to make us more passionate for serving Jesus Christ, not to complain about the foolish little temporal inconveniences of this life, but realize we have the most precious cargo of all, the gospel of Jesus Christ. It cannot be lost. It is permanent. It is eternal. And you've given it into our possession to carry it to those who have not yet heard. Father, we pray your blessings upon your word this evening, for we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, recall as we were looking at the preceding verses in verses 21 and following from our text tonight, we saw that in the context, there are a lot of very important basic Bible doctrines contained in the text. Predestination, election, the sovereignty of God. Those things are connected to the predestined storms of our lives. That was not an accidental storm. That was a storm that God had specifically planned because God was going to use the Apostle Paul to reach a group of 276 people on board the boat, and then he was going to direct the ship to a destination which the ship had not chosen, to an island where there was someone who needed to hear the gospel and people needed to be saved. God was sovereignly in control. He could have stopped that storm at any time. He could have started it at a later point in the journey. He could have caused it to miss them altogether. He did not. He chose that storm at that point in time to reach those folks because he had a purpose that he would accomplish. He had a purpose not only for Paul, but he had a purpose for those traveling with him so that they would see the example of Paul. He had a purpose for the centurion who was in charge of the prisoners, a purpose that included saving the life of Paul. He had a purpose for the sailors. He had a purpose for the soldiers. He had a purpose for the other passengers, all of whom had contact with a man who knew and believed the word of God. You will have predestined storms in your life too. When others around you see you, will they, in fact, say, "This man knows the true and living God"? And what will the impact be that your life has on them? You know, we can be confident that the different predestined storms in our lives are designed by God to cause us to reach specific destinations that He has planned for us. We may think we're headed this way. We do all of our studies and all of our Bible time and quiet time and prayer time and maybe school time and work time and, you know, thinking that we're going to reach a certain destination. Maybe our goal, though it's a carnal one, is someday to settle down in retirement and relax and kick back our feet and have a fun time. Not a great goal for a Christian, but that is what some Christians have as their goals. Perhaps it's a goal to reach the top in our field. Perhaps it's the goal to get a lot of money. Perhaps it's the goal to find ease and luxury and pleasure. What are your goals? Every purpose that comes across in life, think about 5 years, 10 years from now, how does it fit the purpose that God has for your life, not just what you have? Predestined storms. We talked about how Paul looked at many shipwrecks. He was in multiple shipwrecks according to the Bible. We only have one of them recorded for us, but he talks about the many shipwrecks that he was involved in as he goes through that in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And he kept on going through intense trouble without ever giving up because he believed it was predestined for his good and for God's glory, and that God would never allow anything to happen in his life or in your life that does not perfectly fit into the divine plan. You see, Paul embraced the doctrine of predestination, and that gave him perfect confidence, that gave him peace, that enabled him to sail boldly through the horrifying and sometimes extended storms of life, not just physical storms, but the storms of life. Some of those storms involved direct confrontation with Satan. Some involved confrontation with vicious apostates, violent governments, some intense physical, mental, and emotional suffering. And Paul yet says that he glories in all of these things because it gave him confidence that he was squarely in the center of the will of God. Then that brought us, as you recall, to the most dangerous kind of shipwreck, which is spiritual shipwreck, which is completely different. That's a different matter that does not have the benefits of the predestined storms of life. Paul describes spiritual shipwrecks to young Timothy in 1 Timothy 1:19, holding faith and a good conscience, which some, having put away concerning faith, have made shipwreck. If we don't handle the predestined storms of life in the way that God has designed for us to handle those things, we will make spiritual shipwreck. We saw that there are at least 8 different kinds of spiritual shipwreck that are listed in the New Testament. The first kind is doctrinal failure on a central key doctrine of the faith. Paul says, holding faith in a good conscience, which some having put away concerning faith have made shipwreck, of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have delivered unto Satan that they may learn not to blaspheme. And you know what? We discovered exactly what it was that those two men had denied. They had denied the resurrection of Christ. Note, that kind of doctrinal error is called the snare of the devil, because that's always the first line of attack, questioning the faith. The second area of shipwreck we saw was moral failure. First is doctrinal failure. Second is moral failure. The word used for that in the New Testament is the word iniquity. That means moral failure. Many different kinds of sins are listed in the New Testament. When you see the word iniquity, you're talking about moral failure. Paul writes to Timothy again in 2 Timothy 2:19, "Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity." That's moral sin. That includes all the many normal forms of sex outside of marriage, as well as all the perverted forms of sex that are forbidden in all circumstances. Keep away from moral sins if you want to be a clean vessel used by God. And the Apostle Paul talks to Timothy about that in the very next three verses, in verse 20 through 22. In a great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and earth, some to honor and some to dishonor. If a man therefore purge, that means to cleanse himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor. You're carrying something for the master. Sanctified and meet for the master's use, prepared unto every good work. Flee also youthful lusts. That's iniquity. Instead, he gives you what you should do. Follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. The third area of spiritual shipwreck is temptation to the other deadly sins. Of course, lust being one of those which relates to the moral sin, but the other ones are gluttony and sloth, greed, wrath, lust, envy, and pride. Why are those called deadly sins? We're going to talk about that quite a bit tonight, toward the end of the message. But lust is only the first in a long list described by Paul in Romans chapter 1, verses 22 through 32. It's something that is very prevalent here in the United States, sodomy, both male and female. And that passage ends with these words, "Who, knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death." God says that deserves the death penalty. "Not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them." The fourth area of spiritual shipwreck is temptation by the temporal things and standards of the world. We talk quite a bit about that. That includes the way in which we deal with other believers when we insist on our own rights rather than on our responsibilities. You know, you can be perfectly right under the law and still make shipwreck. The fifth area of spiritual shipwreck that we looked at is a combination of doctrinal and moral sin. We saw that illustrated by two different churches in the book of Revelation. Pergamos with two separate false doctrines and Thyatira with Jezebel in the book of Revelation. The sixth area of spiritual shipwreck is yielding to temptation to walk in the flesh rather than walking in the spirit. And the Bible specifically gives us ways to avoid that in Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 through 21 and in Galatians 6, 8. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Paul talks about it also in Romans chapter 7, verses 18 and 25, Romans 8, 1, Romans 8, 5, Romans 8, 8, Romans 13, 14. A lot of passages deal with that. Romans 16, 17, Ephesians 4, 14. We've covered all those in great detail. I'll not go over it again tonight. The seventh area of spiritual shipwreck was the temptation to embrace demonic doctrine. The seventh area of spiritual shipwreck is the temptation to embrace demonic doctrine. You say, how would any Christian ever do that? Because Satan is a deceiver. And if you're not well soaked in the Word of God, you can be deceived. Listen to what Paul says to Timothy in 1 Timothy 4, 1 and following. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, commanding to abstain from meats which God hath created, to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. Of course, that points very directly to the Roman Catholic Church, or organization, it's not a church. For every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving. It also points to this so-called messianic Jewish movement, whereby they are placing themselves back under the dietary laws of the Old Testament. Every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God in prayer. If thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of faith and of good doctrine whereunto thou hast attained. But refuse profane and old wives' fables, and exercise thyself rather unto godliness. Eighth area where believers can make shipwreck is the sin unto death. That's over in 1 John chapter 5, beginning in verse 14 through 19. The sin unto death. This is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will — by the way, that's an important little phrase, according to his will. You can't say, oh God, I want a gold-plated Cadillac, and I want a bunch of beautiful women around me, and we drive through the streets, and everybody's waving their champagne. No, that God won't answer that with a yes. Devil might, but God won't answer that with a yes. If we ask anything according to his will, how do we know his will? We study his word. His word reveals his will for the believer. So the more you know about the word of God, the more precisely you will be able to ask according to his will. If we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he heareth us, whatsoever we ask — remember, that's already modified by according to his will — we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death — so there are some sins which are not sins unto death — but if you see your brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. In other words, praying for him, praying you get out of that sin. Then John says, there is a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray for it. You know, I think that sometimes we're praying for people who have committed a sin unto death. We'll talk about that in a second. But we're not supposed to pray for them. Did you get that? You're not supposed to pray for someone who is sinning a sin unto death. What? Isn't that what it just said? Yes. There is a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray for it. All unrighteousness is sin, and there is a sin not unto death. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. Now that is an habitual present in the Greek, which means he doesn't keep on doing it, keep on doing it, keep on doing it, keep on doing it. But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. And we know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness. Now, James explains about the sin unto death in James chapter 5. That first passage was John chapter 5, 1 John 5. This is James 5 now, beginning in verse 14. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick. Notice, this is not one faith healer. This is a group of elders. This is a man that they know. This is a man in their church. This is a man who is sick. And they are, a special word for anointing here is they're not dribbling oil on his head. That's a word for rubbing oil. The prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, and you remember there are three types of if clauses in Greek. This is the one is if and he has sinned. So there's a guy who's sick because he sinned. He has called for the elders of the church. They didn't just come in on him. He called for them because he knows he's in trouble. He knows he's on his way out. If he's committed sins, that is if and he has, they shall be forgiven him. Because it says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another. That's the context. That you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much, which tells you what the character of the elders must be who come in to pray the prayer of faith over this man. A lot of faith healers say, well, the guy didn't have enough faith to be healed. Here, it's the elders' faith, not the faith of the guy. They are the ones that have to have the faith. We learned about the severity of the sin unto death. It's stubborn, willful sin in many different categories. The sin unto death is not singular in its what is the specific sin. Oh, I just want to avoid that one sin. But I can go ahead and sin in all these other areas and just be flagrant about it. No, we saw that there are many different categories of the sin unto death. And if you willfully, stubbornly, consistently insist on committing that sin when you know you're not supposed to do it, you have been rebuked for doing it, people have come to you and told you that you ought to get out of it, and you still stick your nose up at them, God's going to pull you off the playing field. And it says, when that happens, the believers shouldn't even pray for you. They should not have you on their prayer lists. If I knew of anybody that was committing a sin unto death, you know what? I would not put their name on our prayer list. We pass out a prayer list with hundreds of requests every week. But if I saw that this was an individual and the reason that that individual was in that particular problem was because of habitual, insistent, open, rebellious, stubborn, consistent sin, and he refused to repent, his name comes off the prayer list. Let him die. You say, boy, that's harsh. No, that's what the Bible says. It says, you don't pray for that kind of a guy. Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 24. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. Now listen to verse 26. For if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversary. We're talking about willful sin here. Was because
I believe the Apostle Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. I know there are people who disagree with that, but I think it was Paul.
So Paul here is telling the Jews at Jerusalem, this book was written to the Jews at Jerusalem, and they were facing a coming trial with the Romans going to surround that city and not let any of them out. And there are five warning passages in the book of Hebrews. None of them are warning about loss of salvation, but they are warning about chastening. They are warning about loss of life. They are warning about temporal things versus eternal things. They're warning about heavenly rewards. Five passages in Hebrews, but none of them are talking about the loss of salvation. Here's the warning. It's for willful sin. He that despised Moses' law, there's your Old Testament, died without mercy under two or three witnesses. In other words, gonna die physically. Of how much sorer punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy, who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God, hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified, an unholy thing, and hath done despot unto the Spirit of grace. He's despised the Spirit's work in his life. He's stubbornly, rebelliously, continuing in sin. For we know him that hath said, vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, saith the Lord, and again,
Now listen, who is it that's going to get judged here? The Lord shall judge his people. We're not talking about God judging the pagans. This passage is dealing with God judging his people. And the next verse says it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. You know, God loves you, but he will not put up with sin. Because Jesus died for those sins. Jesus suffered on Calvary's cross for those sins. Why should we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer in this unrighteous, wicked, filthy state? Paul exhorts us to live holy lives. We cannot continue in sin that grace may abound. That's wicked doctrine. And what is the sin in the passage? The particular sin unto death. Because he's talking about people getting killed here. He gives the illustration about people in the Old Testament getting stoned to death. What is the sin? Verse 24 and 25, backing up just a few. Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more, as you see the day approaching. For if we sin willfully, sinning willfully in this context is cutting out a church. Refusing to assemble with the other believers because of what somebody else might think, or because of some persecution, or because of some loss of business. We just don't want to be associated with the believers. We think that's the safer way to do it. God says that's willful sin. If you stubbornly insist on it, I'm going to kill you. Very dangerous. Well, we've seen many different kinds of willful sin, and that brought us to a contrast with the unpardonable sin, which is not the same thing as the sin unto death. Those are two different sins. The unpardonable sin is not the same thing as the sin unto death, because the sin unto death has many subcategories, as we've already discussed. But what then is the unpardonable sin? And we saw that in the three synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which mention it. John does not mention that in the Gospel of John. But one of the synoptic Gospels defines the unpardonable sin, though we see the definition does apply in the other two Gospels. Mark chapter 3, verses 22 through 30. The scribes which came down from Jerusalem said, he hath Beelzebub, and by the prince of devils casts he out devils. That is, they said that Jesus is doing his miracles because he's got the devil in him. And he called them unto him and said unto them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? And if a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan rise up against himself and be divided, he cannot stand, but hath an end. No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, then he'll spoil his house. Now, listen carefully, verses 28 through 30. And the context here. Verily, verily, I say unto you, all sins shall be forgiven unto the sons of men, and blasphemies wheresoever they shall blaspheme. A lot of people have committed blasphemies. You know that. You hear it every day. They take God's name in vain. They take the name of Jesus in vain. But he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost hath never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation. Now, blaspheming against the Holy Ghost does not mean saying the name Holy Ghost and then using a curse word after it. Look at the context, and it tells you in verse 30 what he means. Because, they said, he, that is Jesus, hath an unclean spirit. They saw the miracles of Christ. They had only two options to say what those miracles had behind them for a power. There's obviously God can do miracles. The only other option is the devil. And they chose the wrong answer on the quiz. They said, the scribes which came down from Jerusalem, he hath Beelzebub, and by the prince of devils he casts out devils. That's the point of verse 30. When Jesus talks about the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost, the unpardonable sin, it's because they said he hath an unclean spirit. They saw his miracles and they attributed it to the devil. I personally don't think that that sin can be committed today because we do not see Jesus performing miracles and then being able to say he did that by the power of the devil. But that's the context we have here. Now, we're looking tonight at verses 38 through 44. That gave us the background for what we were looking at here. And here's Paul begging all of them to take meat, saying, "The day is the 14th day that you've tarried and continued fasting, having taken nothing. Therefore, I pray you to take some meat, for this is for your health, for there shall not a hair fall from the head of any of you." And when he had thus spoken, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. Then were they all of good cheer, and they also took some meat. We learned some things about the opening verses in our passage tonight. You know, sometimes there are things that are outside of our intuition. Do you think there are some emotions going on here in this particular context? I suspect so. There are probably moms and dads on board the boat wondering what's going to happen to their kids back home with grandma. There are probably some young men on board the boat wondering, "Oh, will I ever be able to get married? My sweetheart is back." Or maybe a young lady on the boat, you know, "Oh, if only my great hero was here to help me." There were people going through all kinds of different personal, emotional situations because they were facing death, and it wasn't an instantaneous death. They were looking at this for 14 days, 2 weeks in a row, every day, wondering if it would be their last breath. If you were in that situation, would you have some personal, emotional trauma about some unfinished business, things that you should have taken care of, things that you knew you should have done, something wrong that you had done that you hadn't made right, and you thought, "Man, I'm going to have to die and face God with that"? Emotions are a very unstable guide. Be careful about following your emotions when they walk outside of revealed Scripture. We have to take the responses of life by faith in God's word, because God has revealed them in his word. That was true of breaking the fast here after 2 full weeks. Second, this is very important. This is all new material here. Your example and attitude will affect others around you. Your example and your attitude will affect others around you. Did you know that God is going to hold you accountable for the impact that you make on other people's lives? You think, "Oh, he's only going to hold me accountable for what I do and what I think and what I say and what my motives, my attitudes, and it's just all about me." No, it extends beyond you, because you do not live on an island by yourself. You live in community with other people. You live in the context of the body of Christ, and the body of Christ lives in the context of the world that is watching you all the time. God will hold you accountable for the impact that you make on other people's lives. Too often we're so selfish that we only think about ourselves and how is this going to affect me. You know, it's interesting to watch Paul through this context here. Paul is waiting patiently for God to show him what to do. When he got on board the boat, he told them, "Don't take this trip. You know, we're going to have some trouble. You're going to lose your boat. Some of you might die." God hadn't revealed everything to Paul, but he had at least revealed that much. And they laughed at Paul. They said, "Hey, look, you're not a sailor. Hey, you're a scholar. What do you know about sailing? The captain of the ship knows a whole lot more than you do." And so the centurion, you know, he was a pragmatic man. He looked at Paul. He looked at the captain of the ship. He looked at the fact that the captain owned the ship. It would cost him if that ship went down. He looked at the fact that everybody else was getting on board. He looked at the good cargo that they had. It was a heavy-duty ship. It could hold 276 people. "We can probably sail through anything that we got a problem with. We've got the soldiers on board. If pirates attack, we'll beat them off." Paul just watched. You know, sometimes you'll see people around you doing stupid things. You warn them about the stupid things. But you know, you don't have to spend the rest of your life nagging them about their stupid things. They will discover that those things are stupid things. You say, "But look, I showed them the Bible." Yes. "I showed it to them twice." Yes. "I showed it to them 3 times. Yes. And so did these people and those people over there. Now you sit back and say, "All right, Lord, I've done what you asked me to do. It's in your hands. That's what Paul did. He had no other options. He had to get on board. The soldiers were dragging him on board. So he said, okay, God, my life is in your hands. And he sat back and he waited to see what God would do. We never have to rush ahead in life to get our will accomplished. We do serve a sovereign God who has designed the events of life for his glory and for our good. You know, it's rather interesting. Paul didn't panic. He lived through the 14-day storm, the same as the rest of them. He knew that he would not personally drown because God had told him that he was going to bear testimony at Rome. Paul knew that for himself. He was not sweating it for himself. But he also knew that he was surrounded by unbelievers. The Apostle Paul was never timid about presenting the gospel of Christ. We've seen that already as Paul, God's bulldog, went back to cities where they had stoned him and left him for dead. But here we see him waiting, just waiting to see what God is going to do. That's really hard for some of us, isn't it? Waiting to see what God is going to do. Have you ever felt yourself in a panic? You felt the fear rising? You felt agitated and discontent because you were wondering, what's next, what's next? Instead of just saying, I can't control the circumstances of life. I will wait patiently upon the Lord. Next time you are tempted to be agitated, to fall apart at the seams, to throw a hissy fit or a temper tantrum, remember Paul in the storm. He waited patiently to see what God would do. You know, I suspect Paul also prayed for the passengers around him. I can't imagine that he didn't. But he prayed for them. And when God revealed the impossible, that every one of them was going to live through this storm, but the boat was going to sink, that was impossible. There were a lot of people who had never been in the water in their lives. It tells us that at the end of the passage. Some of them could swim, some of them couldn't swim. But when God told him the impossible, Paul believed it, and he proved that he believed it because he started talking about it. That's the very first step. Proving that you believe something is when it looks impossible, when other people are not going to believe it, when you boldly start talking about it. Do you do that with your faith? Are you unashamed to talk to somebody else about Jesus? A couple of days ago, we had the privilege of, Dino and I, of going on board the USS New Jersey down here. And, you know, I like to give out these little track calendars. I bought 2,000 of them. I don't want them to sit around until December. I want to get them all out in the first month of the year if I possibly can. And so the first guy that we saw, we gave one to him up on board the deck. And started talking, and it turned out he was a believer. The first thing that happened was we ended up having fellowship with a man who attends a Bible church not too far from here. And I sat there and talked to him for maybe 5 minutes. What a joy to know that I had a brother in Christ. And we passed him out to other guys on board the ship, and some with more enthusiasm than others took the cards and others did not. And with some we had opportunity to share Christ. Do you try to do that every time you run into somebody? Do you carry tracts with you? If you believe, you will want to tell others. Paul said, I believe God that it shall even be so. And he began to tell them. He told them the impossible. You're all going to live through this, but the boat is going to get broken up. Ship's going to sink. It's all going to go down. But God's going to save every one of you alive. But I've never had a swimming lesson. It's okay. Is there a God in the universe who can do the impossible? Absolutely. Rather interesting here. Paul believed it. He proved it by talking about it. He wasn't embarrassed. He did not edit what God had said. He declared it boldly and publicly in the impossible situation, not at a quiet time in a sitting room someplace in London. God has revealed his will also to you. He's revealed his will for boldly and publicly talking about him in the impossible situations. He's revealed his will to you and others in his word. But most of us are frightened. Most of us are terrified. We're embarrassed. That's really selfish. That's thinking about how's this going to affect me. We're embarrassed to talk about it. You know, you'll never see the blessing of God unless you declare his word. You won't. You will not see the blessing of God unless you're willing to declare his word. Paul didn't declare God's word like a sniveling coward. He was bold. He set the example. There are other people around him while this is going on. And he set the example. He was cheerful. He was not sour. He was not complaining. How often do you find yourself being sour or complaining? Now, you may not want to admit it. I know a lot of people who want to say they are never sour and that they are never complaining. Look, you're only fooling yourself. Everybody else can see it. Paul was cheerful. He was not sour or complaining, even though it was a miserable situation for Paul, just as it was a miserable situation for everybody else. Some of you have seen the original film, The Hiding Place. And you know my brother made another film, The Return to the Hiding Place. And in the original film, here they are, Betsy and Corey, are in this miserable Ravensbrück concentration camp. And they go in, and the dormitory where all these women are jammed together is filled with lice. And Corey makes the comment, "How can I ever be thankful for lice?" She's really glum, really down. And Betsy is not. Because Betsy has heard that because of the lice, nobody among all the German guards will ever come into that barracks, into that dormitory area. Because they don't want to get lice. And so Betsy turns to Corey and she says, "Thank God, even for the lice." At another point, the principal violinist of the Warsaw Philharmonic Orchestra, who is in the concentration camp, whose hands have been mangled so she can no longer play the violin, she talks about and says, "Well, you know, how can your God, this God of love that you talk about, do this to me?" And Betsy responds, "You know, we see the world around us, but we also see another world. A world where there's light and beauty." This tender spirit that Betsy had, and she died in that concentration camp, affected all of the women around her. What kind of spirit do you have? Do you bellyache and gripe and complain all the time about the little tiny inconveniences that you're experiencing? And you let everybody else know about it. It's too cold in here, or it's too hot in here. Have you ever been in a concentration camp? What would your spirit be if you even lived to walk through the front door? Would you be thankful? The Apostle Paul says, "In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." Look at what Paul is doing here. Do you think his example and attitude affected others around him? I think it clearly did. He was cheerful, not sour and complaining. He started eating bread soaked in cold seawater. When was the last time you ate bread soaked in cold seawater and you yourself are drenched to the skin and you're grinning and thankful for doing it? Paul is setting an example. Notice something else. The way he ate his bread, he did it in the same manner that Jesus taught the disciples to celebrate the Lord's table. He broke the bread in their presence. And then he ate. Paul was reminding them that the covenant promises of God are true. He was reminding them of the broken body of Christ and that payment had already been made for their sins. Verse 35, and when he had thus spoken, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. He's just told them this is what God's going to do. And he thanks God and he takes the bread and it says, and he had broken it before them, he began to eat. Look at verse 36. How did it affect the people around him? Then were they all of good cheer. And they also took some meat. It affected their attitude and it affected their actions. Because one man said, I believe God. And I'm going to prove I believe God because I'm first telling you about it. And number two, I'm going to act on it. Do you believe God? And so you tell others? And then do you act upon it in a way that shows that your life has been changed? And you do it with joy, not with a glum spirit? Notice here, everybody followed the directions of Paul at this point. Of course, they had nothing to lose. Sometimes the only way people will ultimately respond to the word of God is when all human hope has been taken away. All human hope had been taken away here. And you know something? God often does that in the lives of those who are struggling against him. They've used every human effort to solve their own problems. And they don't give up until there are no other options. I suspect all of us know some people that are like that. Perhaps you're even praying for their salvation. You know, God may have to take them to the final breaking point before they yield to his irresistible grace. But God wants to use you along the way. Remember, we talked about that this morning. God said to Moses, now here's an impossible situation, just like this. God said to Moses, okay, you're standing on the bank of the Red Sea here. Now, I tell you what, I want you to lift up your hand, your rod over the sea, and I'll do that. I'll part the sea just as soon as you do that. Moses probably scratched his head and said, oh, whoa. I mean, Lord, can't I sort of have everybody say, hey, turn around, look, there's Pharaoh. And while they're doing it, then I'll stick it out and then pull it back before they see me doing it. I mean, I don't want to be embarrassed in front of all those people. You know what? God would not have parted the sea unless Moses, his chosen vessel, had first obeyed. What blessing, what deliverance, what objective act in history has not happened because you or I did not obey when we knew the will of God? Now, God will accomplish his purpose with somebody besides you and with somebody besides me. But at that point in history, what would God have done if we had obeyed him? What difference would there have been if we had obeyed him in what we thought was an impossible situation? This is an impossible situation. Moses was in an impossible situation. But God said, here's my will, do it. When we obey, we see the blessings of God. You know, something very interesting also, here in the text, they've already done their very human best to bring the ship safely to land. That's not wrong. Obviously, they tried to save their own lives. But you know, there is a difference between them trying as hard as they could before what Paul did and trying as hard as they could after what Paul did. We have to always act on the basis of faith when God gives us the option of acting. For example, we talked about Peter being chained up in prison before. We went through that passage and incredible things happening there. That's another impossible situation where God opened the door and Peter didn't think it was happening. Peter thought he was still asleep. But there was no hope. And when they responded in faith, God kept his promise. They'd already been doing their best, but it was not enough. They had reached the point of no return, the point of absolute hopelessness, before God gave them a promise of hope. They responded in faith, and God kept his promise. Their initial efforts had ended in failure, but now it says, when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. God brought them to the point of no hope. They couldn't do it. They also proved that they believed the promise of God because they not only were willing to take bread and eat because God had promised it, but they were willing to give up all of their temporal goals for making money. They're willing to give up all their personal possessions, willing to leave it behind for the only important thing that mattered in the context, their lives. They gave all the rest of it up. Now, you know, I've just finished flying back and forth to Georgia over Christmas, and then I drove around and got over to Alabama. But, you know, it's interesting. I noticed something on that flight, thinking about this passage here and thinking about the impossible situations. And on every flight I think that I've ever flown, the stewardess had got up and she goes through the thing about, you know, your life vest, and you put it over your head, and if it doesn't automatically inflate, you put the little thing in your mouth and you blow into it until it inflates, and that when it hits the water, the little light will turn on and all that kind of stuff if the plane goes down over water. Of course, if you jump out with your life vest and you're in the desert, it doesn't do you much good. But anyway, there we have it. But you know, she always said something else. She said, in case of an emergency, and they always say this, in case of an emergency, leave all your personal belongings behind and proceed to the nearest exit. They always tell you first to find the one that's closest, and it might be behind you and all that kind of stuff. But it's leave all your personal belongings behind. Now, can you imagine? You're on a flight, and you're in this seat, and right in front of you is a fat lady who has a big suitcase, and the door is in the next seat. What would it be like if she screams and says, but I don't want to lose my clothes. I bought them at Neiman Marcus, or I bought them at Macy's, or I bought them at I've got a big fancy coat. I've got some jewelry. And she's opening the thing and trying to get this big suitcase out. What's that going to do for the rest of the passengers? Guarantees they die. They can't get past her and her big lunky suitcase. Leave all your personal belongings behind. What? My briefcase has got money in it. Leave all your personal belongings behind. You know something? That's what they did here. They were willing to give up all of their temporal personal possessions. They were willing to leave it all behind for the only important thing that mattered, their lives. A number of years ago, I read a very interesting book on true stories of plane crash survivors. And you know something about every one of them? The people who survived followed all of those rules that we've just talked about. They focused on only one thing. They focused on leaving all behind so that got them off the plane. You know, the people on board the ship had learned that lesson. They were not tied down by their wealth. They were not tied down by the load of wheat which was about to go down in the sea. They were not tied down by all the baggage that they had down below in the below the decks. You know, it wouldn't do them any good if they drowned, would it? It says, when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship. They cast out the wheat into the sea. And when it was day, they knew not the land. They discovered a certain creek with a shore into which they were minded if it were possible to thrust the ship. They wanted to get as close as possible before the ship went down. Nothing wrong with that. You know, something else is not wrong to be careful about your health. We just went over that very quickly the last time we were together. But let me detail that a little bit more here. Paul exhorted them to eat as it was necessary for their health. They were going to need it when they got to shore. It's not improper to take good care of your health. Now, you know, you may have some kind of a thorn in the flesh. Paul had a thorn in the flesh that God gave to him to keep him humble. But generally, you'll be better servant of Christ if you're careful about your health. However, if God has given you a thorn in the flesh, he will enable you to deal with it in a way that is for his glory and for your good. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations," in other words, God did this to keep him humble, "there was given to me a thorn in the flesh." People have posited that perhaps that thorn in the flesh was the bad eyesight that he had. "The messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure." Now here's what I want to talk about. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. God commands you to treat it properly and with moral purity and care. You know, there are many passages in the New Testament that teach that. We'll just go them quickly tonight, maybe be able to touch them a little more in depth next week. But for example, 1 Corinthians 3, verses 16 and 17. "Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are." Or about chapter 6, verse 18 through 20. "Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth who is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body." You say, well, so what? He tells you what in verse 19. What? "Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you're not your own?" You better take care of your body because it is the temple of the Holy Spirit. "You're bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." You don't belong to yourself. Your body doesn't belong to you. All these women out there that are saying, well, it's my body and I can take part of my body out and kill it. No, no, they're talking about their baby, and that's a separate body and that's a separate person. Certainly, if you're a Christian, your body is not your own because you are bought. You are purchased with the price of the blood of Christ. How about chapter 6 in 2 Corinthians? We've got a 1 Corinthians 6, now a 2 Corinthians 6. "Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? What communion hath light with darkness? What concord hath Christ with Belial? What part hath he that believeth with an infidel? What agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you. And ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty." You are a temple. You'd better not defile the temple. God lives in you. He walks in you. How about Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19 through 22? "Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens of the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building..." Here's the foundation, the apostles and prophets. You're being built up, you're part of this building, "fitly framed together, groweth into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit." If any man defile the temple of God, 1 Corinthians 3:17, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. Do you think you should be taking care of your body? Now, you don't focus on it like the world does, but you better take care of it, because that's where God lives, inside of you. What are some of the sins that defile the temple of God? Man, I can see my time is already out. Well, there's a lot more on here. I want to talk about the things that defile the temple of God. But I will give you a hint where you can start, and I hope you study some of this week. Think about the seven deadly sins. Gluttony, does that defile the temple of God? Lust, does that defile the temple of God? Anger, sloth, pride, envy, greed. Did you know that every one of those hurts your body? You say, really? Envy? Yeah. A number of scientific studies have been done on that. And the specific types of diseases that seem to be linked to that. By the way, let me give you a budak. You all know what a budak is, right? Where you got a funny looking little word, and each letter of that little word stands for something different, and it helps you to remember like lists of things. Well, here's a budak for the seven deadly sins. Think about, you are trying to put something together, and there are these two holes that are there, and you got to fasten them with a peg, but the only peg you've got is a glass peg. Glass peg, but only with one S. G-L-A-S-P-E-G. G, gluttony. L, lust. A, anger. S, sloth. P, pride. E, envy. G, greed. Glass peg. That'll help you remember the seven deadly sins. A good little budak. Well, we're going to talk about that, but we'll have to let that go till next week. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you very much for your word and for its power. We thank you that when we face the storms of life, they are always under your sovereign control, and they are designed for your glory and for our good. Father, how we thank you that in your mercy and in your grace, you give to us the opportunity for responding properly, because how we respond will affect not merely our own selves, but it affects others around us, and we will give an account for how we have made an impact on the lives of people who have heard us, who have seen us, who have perceived our attitudes and our motives, who've watched the things that we do, heard the words that we speak, and very quickly begin to perceive what we're thinking. Father, we pray that we might be the kind of people that the Apostle Paul was. Total crisis in life, impossible situations, and yet, like Moses, Paul knew your word. We have your word. It's complete, it's finished, it's final. No more new special revelation being given. Everything that we need for life is here, the Bible. But a lot of us don't really know it because we don't bother to study it. And so we don't know how to respond when the storms of life hit us. But Paul knew. And it gave him confidence. It gave him peace. It gave him the ability to proclaim it without embarrassment and eat some soggy bread soaked in seawater with a spirit filled with joy and peace. And it changed everybody around him. Father, keep us from being a people who complain, who moan and groan, who bellyache and gripe. Israel did that 10 times, and you killed them in the wilderness for doing it. You specifically said that's the reason you killed them. You were tired of listening to them gripe and bellyache and complain about diddly-frit, foolish, stupid little stuff. And they died. Help us not to be like that. Give us the same spirit that the Apostle Paul had, that radiates the love and joy and peace, the fruit of the Spirit, every day in every circumstance, that Jesus Christ would be glorified. We pray these things in his name. Amen. Our closing hymn for tonight.